Thank you so much for coming out tonight to Darien Library. My name is Erin and I do the programs here. I would just like to briefly mention that programs at Darien Library are made possible by our annual Friends of the Library campaign. So thank you so much for your continued support to make events like these available to our community. How many people here are in town for the reunion this weekend? Great. So tonight's guest was raised in Darien and graduated from Darien High School. I won't tell you the year, but many of you can probably guess. All right, yeah. It's the 50th high school reunion. I wasn't sure if she wanted me to let you guys know or not. She attended Drew University in Madison, New Jersey, receiving a BA degree in sociology in 1967. It was at Drew that she met her future husband, John, a physics major. After their marriage in 1969, John was hired by the CIA to be a paramilitary officer. Together, they traveled to Laos in 1971, where John managed Lao irregular troops as they attempted to interdict North Vietnamese troops and war material headed to South Vietnam along the Ho Chi Minh Trail. In 1972, John was killed in a helicopter accident. She returned to Virginia and applied to be an operations officer with the CIA. Her career with the CIA lasted 32 years. She retired in 2003 to Wilmington, North Carolina, where she has been a volunteer with Habitat for Humanity, Lower Cape Fear Hospice, and Life Care Center, and the Wrightsville Beach Turtle Watch. So please join me in welcoming to Darien Library, Miss Marty D. Peterson.
Thank you.
Thank you, Erin, very much. Oh, what a thrill to be here. I can only tell you, they built the library just for us folks. It's amazing that we even found it, huh? Thank you so much, all of you, for coming. Who are the classmates? See, I didn't have the benefit. Yes. Oh, that's good. That's great. We're going to have a great weekend celebrating our 50th class reunion. I remember my mother refused to go to hers. I think she thought they were all old people, so, you know. but we're looking forward to ours. I often ask people, why do they come to a book talk by an author? And they never say, I came here to listen to you read your book. So trust me, I won't read my book tonight. I did want to tell you why I wrote the book, because I think that sets the tone. I wrote the book in memory of my husband, John Peterson, who, she said, died in 1972. We were both 27. That is a very short life, but he packed it full. And this book contains excerpts from his journal, and I included them because I think they speak to the man he was. And I think if you read that, you will understand what I'm talking about. I also wrote the book to reveal who I am, and that always kind of amazes people. But I worked 32 years undercover, and so I lied to everyone about who I was. I told them I worked for various government agencies, whoever I was told to say at the time, and I lied to my mother and father. I lied to the dentist, the guy at the grocery store, a couple of mortgage companies, but we resolved that. And it became a way of life just to say I worked for anyone else but CIA. And of course, if you do that, what you're not doing is claiming an association with an organization. So you really don't have to defend CIA when something awful happens. So I could just blithely go on and really not have a public opinion about the latest CIA scandal. So when I retired in 2003 to Wilmington, North Carolina, where I now live, I could say I worked for CIA for 32 years. Well, of course, like I knew would happen, that it involved people saying, well, what do you think about waterboarding? Or what do you think about the Benghazi affair? Or what do you think? And I have to formulate an opinion because I, in fact, did work 32 years and very proudly. My opinion about any of those things, if you ask me, is the same as yours. I don't know anything more than you do anymore, because after 10 years, you're long past knowing any of the current secrets. I also wrote this book because a man told me to. He had heard me tell my story at work, and he said, your story has value. It has value about what the CIA did during the Cold War, and it has value because you're a woman working in this organization, which was somewhat difficult. He said, go home to Wilmington, sit down, and write the book. Well, I really respected that man. He was retired Special Forces Colonel. He'd seen his share of action. He'd also worked for me for the last 5 years where I was in the counterterrorism center. And so I knew that he was a very smart man, had taken a lot of risks himself. And I figured, well, if he thought that I could go home and write a book about this, then I guess I could. So I took his direction and went home to Wilmington, and that's what I did. I decided to write this memoir, but I didn't know really when to start it. I knew where I was conceived, but I figured that would be a very long book and probably not particularly interesting. So I decided I would, in fact, write a real memoir. A memoir in kind of encompasses a time or a period in your life or an event even or a person that changes your life forever. And so this event of John dying, John's life, our life together, and then his dying, as well as then my early career in the CIA, were events in my life that changed me forever. And I was never quite the same person. I joined a writing group. We wrote four type pages a week. I wrote on a Toshiba laptop. I would sit down and write like crazy. It was like it all fell out of my brain onto the page until I got to the part where John died. And I found that I couldn't commit that to a typewriter. So I went into my living room and I got a yellow pad and I sat down and I began writing with a pen on this yellow pad. As I wrote, I cried, and I went through the time we had together and then the day they came and told me that he had died. And it was through this process of physically writing this that I could relive and remember that day. A friend of mine later on said, oh, I'm so sorry. You were so sad for so long, and it took writing this. And I said, you know, it wasn't that I was grieving all those years. It was the fact that I was remembering the loss of a wonderful man. And that loss, you never fill in. It's always a hole in your heart. And that's what I was going through and remembering it. This part of the book also gave me a chance to reminisce with John. For you who have been married for years and years and years, you have time to sit together over a bottle of wine and reminisce about the time you embarrassed yourself in front of your mother or, you know, forgot to pick the kids up at school or whatever stupidness you do as a married couple. But see, for John and I, we hadn't been married yet for 3 years. And it was my time writing this book when I could reminisce about our years together. I had a New York agent, which was a gift from a friend of mine who had also written a book. And I thought, hey, with a New York agent, this is gold. This is going to sell fast, right? Well, he tried to sell my book to the 6 big publishing houses, and they all sent a note back. Oh, very interesting, very nice story. Yeah, but it's about the Cold War. You know, who's interested? We're more interested in terrorism these days. So with that, my agent said, well, why don't we get a writer to help you spruce up the book, make it more literary, more dynamic? So I said, you know, go for it. So he found this writer who was willing to work with me. And he said, come up to New York and I'll introduce you and we'll go through, you know, see if it'll be a good fit. So I went to New York and I sat down with this woman. She had name recognition. Lisa Pulitzer. Well, I thought, this is a no-brainer, right? We'll have the front of the book. Martha Peterson, with Lisa Pulitzer, but it'll sell books. Well, Lisa Pulitzer wanted me to be an angry, disgruntled woman who had worked and then retired from CIA, who was going to do a tell-all. Well, you see, that wasn't my story. And she wanted $40,000 to do it. And of course, that really wasn't my story. So I went home to Wilmington and I bought the book, Self-Publishing for Dummies, and I wrote the book my way. And it turned out my way, which I think is the only way it could have. The book starts in Laos in 1971 when John and I are headed to Paksay. This is a map of Laos. Paksay is the southernmost city in Laos, and it had, well, it was the third largest city. It had one paved road. So we landed there. It had a paved airport landing strip. We landed there. John was given as his office car a Land Rover, British-made Land Rover. So it had the steering wheel on the right, and then the shift was left. They didn't screw up the pedals, so that made it easy. So the first day, he said, let's go into town and see what's what there. So we got into the Land Rover, and off we went into town, around the corner, and here were two donkeys copulating in the middle of the street. And he looked over at me like, is she going to bolt? You know, is she going to get on the next plane out of here? But I didn't, because it was where we were assigned, and that was what we did in those days. It wasn't too dangerous, I guess, for wives to be there. But the war was raging, and it was 10 or 12 kilometers away from our home. We could hear the noise of war, and we could see evidence of it as well. We didn't go touring around outside of town because the war was that close. John's job there as a CIA officer was to interdict the flow of men and war materials south along the Ho Chi Minh Trail, which is the black line there. That's somewhat of an approximation of the Ho Chi Minh Trail. And those troops were North Vietnamese Army troops headed to South Vietnam. And CIA's job was to stop the flow of that war material and arms and people to South Vietnam, where they would engage with the U.S. military. And we did a hell of a job. In fact, it's one of the successes, they say, of the Vietnam War. There are several books written on it. It's called The Secret War in Laos. And I'm sure, you know, those of you who are interested, you know, can read more about that. But our life there was crude. In this day and age, it is hard to believe that we lived in such a remote place where there were no TV, no radio, no newspapers, of course, no internet, no cell phone, you know, these things that we take for granted now. But I couldn't even pick up the phone and call my mother and father. We were at the end of the road there, and the only thing we got were, of course, the ball scores, whether it was the baseball season or football or basketball. And those they published on the door of the camo shack. So we had to keep up to date with that. Our food, of course, was from the local market, and occasionally we would get shipments in from Vientiane, where there was a commissary. Both parents, sets of parents, came to visit us. I don't know what they were thinking. Can you imagine traveling that far around the world to see us? But I think they were all curious about what life was really like for us. And you know, life was rather normal. I mean, we had a kitchen and I cooked food and we, you know, had weekends, although John worked all the time. So life was somewhat normal, whatever you establish is normal. So my parents arrived in Bangkok and we went down, John and I went down to pick them up. We put them on a funny little plane with no insignia really. It was really Air America. And we traveled to Paksay. We got out of the airport and put my mother and father in this Land Rover and took them to our house, which was called, which I describe as a French colonial. It had two stories. Well, that I guess kind of it describes a French colonial. But it was an okay house. It was comfortable. We had two air conditioners. So my mother got out of the Land Rover, and as she went to step up on the front step, there was a flower garden to the right of the front step. It only had rocks in it. I hadn't planted anything in it. And she stepped up and she turned and she looked at the flower garden and she said, "Martha, is that a marijuana plant?" And I said, "Gee, Mom, I don't know." Well, you know, I truly didn't know. My mother died in 1990, and I never asked her how she knew it was. That was Dorothy. It was. So they spent the week with us. John went out with my dad, and John showed him around what he was doing in the various areas, and introduced him to people in town and all. And my mom and I went to the market and, you know, traveled around. And so one afternoon, we're sitting in the living room in our little Lao house. We had shutters over the window. We didn't have any glass in the window because of the concussion of mortars and bombs, things like that. So we're sitting in the living room. And in the distance, we hear boom, 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 boom. And Mother said, "Martha, what's that?" And I said, "Mother, that's Lao thunder." Well, she didn't ask anymore. The sky was as blue as it was today here. So we got to Bangkok, and I said to her, "Mother, remember the Lao thunder I told you about?" I said, "Well, those were Lao pilots flying T-28 bombers going out to bomb the North Vietnamese positions right outside of town, certainly within earshot." I think Mother understood, and my dad understood, this was a kind of a safe place. It was the life we'd chosen, as all of our children eventually do. Okay, now I stop my talk here and I fast forward to 2005. I'm on an airplane to Los Angeles to visit my daughter. She works in nightclubs there, so she's ordered a van to come pick me up at the airport. I'm coming down the escalator, guy holds a sign up, I say, "That's me." He goes over, we get my bag, go out and get into the van. As we drive out of the Los Angeles airport, I'm looking up at him in the mirror and I say, "Where are you from?" And he said, "Oh, I'm from the Far East." And I said, "Oh, where?" And he said, "Thailand." And I said, "Oh, really?" I said, "I used to live in Laos." And he said, "Oh, in Vientiane?" That's the capital. I said, "No, I lived in Pak Sae." And he said, "My mother lives in Pak Sae." He said, "I used to live in Pak Sae. I was a T-28 bomber pilot who used to work for the CIA." So I said, "Well, you must have known my husband, Tamak," which was his Lao nickname. He said, "I knew Tamak." He said, "I knew Kam Singh. I knew Noi and Ratana, all the men that I had been there and John had been there with." Well, there wasn't a dry eye in the van. It was just the two of us. And we laughed and we cried. I had to find out how he had gotten to Los Angeles. You know, he had five sons. He was educating them there. He'd gone through, you know, refugee camps and all. Well, we had such a conversation on the way to my daughter's apartment. So we get out at the apartment building. My daughter's waiting. She comes out and we hug, and then I turn around to get my bag, and he and I embrace and laugh again and cry. And my daughter's looking at this and she said, "Mom, it was such a short trip." Small world. So John and I had our life planned, you know, as you do when you're young. You plan where you're going on vacation, you're going to plan when you're going to have babies, you plan all the future together. And then on October 19th, 1972, the man came through the door, a good friend of ours, and said, "John's gone." And my life stopped at that moment forever. Everything that I'd planned and we'd planned together, it's hard. It's just an impossible thing to even get your mind around. But you make the best friends in the worst places. Those of you who have been in bad places know that's true. And these friends of ours were absolutely the truest friends. I came back to Washington and eventually decided to live in Washington. And friends sitting over bottles of wine and wondering what I was going to do said, "Why don't you apply to the CIA?" Well, it was the farthest thing from my mind. That was John's life, certainly not mine. But I decided I would give it a shot. And after they decided that I really didn't want to be a secretary because I kept thinking I should be a secretary, I was hired as an operations officer, a CIA case officer. I went through the full operational training and I was certified. And my first assignment they gave me was to go to Burma, Rangoon, Burma. Well, you know, I never wanted to go back to the Far East. That really wasn't it. And the worst part, they wanted me to take 44 weeks of Burmese language. Well, you know one place they don't speak Burmese? In Burma, they speak the Queen's English there. And there's no other place in the world you could ever speak Burmese. So I turned down my assignment. I said, no, I didn't want to go back to that part of the world. It would be just too hard to do. So they shopped my file around, and they said, well, would you go to Moscow? And I said, well, I would. And would you learn 44 weeks of Russian language? And I said, well, that for sure I would do. So I studied the language. I had specialized training in how to operate on the street in Moscow. And on November 5th of 1975, I arrived at Sheremetyevo Airport in Moscow. Why did I take such a hard assignment? Well, I guess some of you here may know me better than others, some from a very long time ago. I guess I like challenges, and I like to do things that are out of the ordinary. But there's also a theory, my friend Dewey over here would tell you, that it was to even the score. That the helicopter that John was on was shot down by an AK-47 that was made in the Soviet Union. So maybe there was an inkling of evening the score of going to Moscow and sticking it to the Soviets. I was the only woman, and it got to be an old story. I was the only woman in the station in Moscow, in the American embassy. CIA had a station. It used to be we couldn't say these things out loud. Now they allow us to say what's obvious. And from that station in Moscow, we ran Soviet agents, covert agents, Soviet citizens who were providing information to the American government. So as the only woman there, I was scrutinized by my peers who weren't quite sure that I was up to the task. But also the people who thought I wasn't up to the task, I guess, was the KGB, because they could have cared less that I was in Moscow. I guess they thought I was an administrative officer or a secretary who didn't operate on the street. Because after I was there very short time, we discovered that I didn't have surveillance coverage like my male colleagues did. I could go anywhere in town anytime and nobody followed me. So you ask me, how did you know they didn't follow you? Well, we were trained to seek ways of discovering whether people were following us. But we also had this wonderful piece of gear. It was called the SRR-100, and it was a receiver. It received voice transmissions from the radios that the KGB surveillance teams used to talk to each other. So the surveillance teams would go out following my male colleagues, and the guys would hear through a little earpiece they had, the targets going right, the targets stopped, the targets going on, the targets lost, the targets home, the targets at the embassy, and when I went out, this is what I heard. Nothing. Because they weren't following me. This SRR-100 looked like it was as small as a cigarette pack, but it was metal and it had very sharp corners. The men in the station had a harness that they sewed for them in headquarters. And this SR100 little radio like this would fit into this pocket in the harness. Then the neck loop would come up. It had a connector at the top of the SR100. And this loop would come up, and it was a plastic neck loop that would go around your neck. And then you had this little wireless earpiece in your ear. And you turn it on, and you could hear this. Well, that particular harness wasn't made for my anatomy. So I would tuck the radio in the front of my bra. Well, like I said, it was metal and it had very sharp corners. So when I leaned over, it would poke. And when I leaned either way, it would poke. So in 1976, this will shock you, we got a brand new invention in Moscow. It was called Velcro. With this Velcro, I took a t-shirt, I ripped it up, I made this lovely little pocket for it, and I Velcroed it onto the side of my bra where I could wear this in comfort. So there wasn't a day or a night that I didn't go out without this SR100 on. And like I said, it verified that I had no surveillance coverage. The KGB simply didn't care. So in 1973, while I'm going through all my training in CIA in Washington, we are recruiting a Soviet spy in Bogota, Colombia. Our CIA station in Bogota had a telephone tap on the Soviet embassy in Bogota. And through this, we learned about a Soviet citizen there, a Soviet a diplomat in the embassy, that he was having an affair with a foreign woman there, and that he had had some car accidents. He was not in good stead with the people in his section in the Soviet embassy. He was basically disgruntled, but he was also a Soviet that liked to color outside of the lines. He always wanted to do it a little differently. So we went to his girlfriend and through her arranged for a meeting with him in the Turkish bath in the Hilton Hotel in Bogota. It was there that he agreed to work for the CIA. Why did we choose this Turkish bath? Well, nobody could wear a microphone, right? You can, a towel is a towel, right? you can't really hide too much under a towel. So that's why we chose the Turkish bath. And he agreed to work for us, to spy against the Soviet government. Why did he do that? He said he wanted to change his system from within. Well, maybe those were the beginning days of the downfall of the Soviet Union. But what he gave us over the next 2 or 3 years was some of the most valuable intelligence we could receive. In the Soviet embassy in Bogota, he worked in the econ section there, and he provided communiques that they were receiving from other ambassadors in Latin America. He would take our miniature camera that we trained him in. It was concealed in a very large fountain pen, a black fountain pen. He would take that pen into the embassy, and he would put his elbows down on his desk, place a paper below him, and he would take perfectly focused, squared pictures of all these documents. Then he would return the pen to us, and we would develop the film. That's the other thing. Sometimes I have to explain to younger groups what a fountain pen is, and two, how do you develop film? Well, you know, these things have changed, haven't they? But he was a wonderful agent. He loved taking the training, he loved being the best agent, and he loved producing this amazing intelligence for us. So he also agreed then to go back to Moscow and spy for the US government in Moscow. We didn't know what access he would have once he went back to Moscow, but he knew the types of things we were interested in. Before he left Bogota, though, he asked us for one thing, and it really was a stipulation of his cooperation. He said, "I want a way of committing suicide if I get caught." So basically, he was asking us for an L pill. I was so new to the CIA, I didn't know that we ever did this. And I learned even then that it was very rare that we agreed to do this. But Trigon, which was his code name, Trigon, he was such an exceptional man, and he was so adamant that this be fulfilled. We didn't give him the L pill until he returned to Moscow, but we did give him to carry back with him a schedule of drops in Moscow, as well as a secret writing carbon and some one-time pads. The one-time pads were to use to decipher messages we sent to him by a radio broadcast, or to decipher secret writing that we would send to him. So he went back in late 1974. And then he was on what we called on ice. We didn't contact him then for almost a year because we wanted him to get used to life back in Moscow. We knew he'd have to go through various security reinvestigations, and we knew he had to find a new position in the government there, all of which he did with great ease. So when I arrived on November 5th, 1975, he was ready to communicate with us, and he sent us a signal that he wanted to deliver a drop to us in early December of 75. Picking up packages in Moscow is an art, and it was something we were all trained to do. We cased, like, you know, bank robbers, we cased for sites where we could communicate with our agents. And this site that we had cased, we'd given to Trigon before he left Bogota, so we had it in his secret materials. It was along the Naberezhnaya, which is the river sidewalk along the Moscow River in Moscow. Our deputy chief of mission, deputy chief of station, Jack Downing, is a Marine. Once a Marine, always a Marine. And he went running every morning, no matter how cold it was. He would leave his apartment, he put on his jogging outfit, he'd leave his apartment, he would run down the river, down this Naberezhnaya on the side of the river, he'd do a U-turn and come back. Well, on the coming back portion, there was a portico over the sidewalk, and that's where the site was, where Trigon was going to leave his package. So that morning, Jack went out on his run. It must have been 15 below. It was cold that winter. His surveillance, of course, had watched him do this every morning. So they were comfortable. They went, watched him go down, he'd turn around and come back. So you know where they sat, in their warm cars. So they didn't follow him on foot. And as he came back through that sidewalk portico, he reached down, he picked that package up quickly and tucked it inside his jogging outfit. Went back to his apartment. Surveillance never thought that anything had ever happened. Inside of the package was a triangular pyramid-shaped milk carton that was kind of crushed. And inside were two pages that looked like children's drawings. One was a sailboat type picture, and the other was, it looked like a jungle gym picture. But on the back of those pages was the secret writing that he sent to us. So our tech officer in the station developed them. And it said, "I am so glad to finally be back in touch with you. I've divorced my wife. I didn't want to continue to involve her in this nefarious affair. And I've gotten a wonderful job." He said, "I know the CIA is in trouble because of the church committee meetings." And of course, that was after Watergate and all. And he said, "And I really hope this job that I have gotten will help you." He got a job in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, where he had access to all the incoming communiques with Soviet ambassadors around the world. So the ambassador in Bonn, in the Soviet embassy in Bonn, would write about the status of what was happening in Germany. The one in Tokyo, the same. The one in Buenos Aires, the same. And of course, the one in Washington, D.C. Anatoly Dobrynin was writing his notes back to Moscow. And there was Trigon taking pictures of these documents. We, of course, were very pleased with this, and we cautioned him about taking too much risk. We provided him then in a drop in the next couple weeks his camera in the black pen. He actually had three black pens. He had one that was unmodified that he could carry in his pocket all the time. So if anyone ever needed to use a pen, he could sign whatever. The second pen contained the camera. So he carried that one when he needed to take pictures, and he was going to take pictures for us in his job. The third pen, though, contained the L pill. In the barrel of the pen, down near the reservoir of ink, we put a glass capsule. And in the event he got caught or thought he was going to be apprehended, he could bite down on that. I delivered that pen to him. It always was a moment that stilled my heart because I felt so responsible for this man. Somebody asked me if I ever met Trigon personally. I never did. But I always felt very responsible for this man. This was the reason I was in Moscow, and this was the reason I was out on the street. So Trigon, we delivered to him this pen to take pictures. He began producing. The little miniature cassettes that fit down into that pen held 60 to 80 documents per cassette, and he gave us 8 or 10 of these cassettes every time. You can imagine the number of documents that is, and they were always squared off and very in focus. He was an amazing agent. The way we kind of communicated to him on a regular basis, and I say regular, it was more like every other month, certainly not in the winter. Winter was very difficult. The snow was immense, and the temperatures were very, very cold. So he didn't show up in the winter, but in the spring, summer, fall, every month, every 2 months. So we would communicate with him via dead drop. Dead drop is a secret cache that we have cased, we have sketched, and we have provided a description to Trigon on little miniature film that he keeps hidden away in little concealment devices. So he can pull it out, and we give him a schedule of when and where the caches are. So one of the places we used often was in Park Pobiedy in Moscow. It's a war park, a war memorial park. And it was next to a lamppost there. We like to use lampposts because they're numbered. There's nothing worse than sending an agent out to say, okay, it's a third lamppost from the right. Well, which way do you start counting? So if you tell him it's W36 or V36, then he would know exactly which one it was. So this site in Park Pobiedy, we nicknamed Lies, which means forest. And we use this very often. Because I had no surveillance, I could return to these places where these dead drop sites were and reuse them, whereas guys who were working with surveillance could only use a site once because surveillance would be smart about, well, he went by there 2 weeks ago. I wonder why he's coming by here again. But with me, because I was never followed, I could reuse these sites. So Les was in Park Pobiedy next to a lamppost down inside the park. The way I got to it would be I had a day job in the embassy. I can't really talk about the day job. If you want to know about my day job, just go on the internet and you can Google it and find out what I did, if you get my drift. But at night, after I did my day job, I'd go up to the station and I would get the package. And it was either a log, a hollowed out log, which our tech had very well disguised and sealed, or it was a piece of concrete or asphalt about this big around that thick. So I would go up to the station after I did my day job, and then I would pick this package up, I would go home, change my clothes into dark clothes, and then go out in my car and drive for 2.5 hours to see whether I had surveillance. The last thing I ever wanted to do was to miss the fact that I had surveillance following me just by chance. Then I'd park my car downtown and get into the metro. I would ride several stops, change, ride some more stops, get off, and go then on foot to the site. The site was well down into this park, and it was a long walk. I got there by walking under a path that went under a canopy of trees beside the roadway. The roadway was only one way coming opposite me, so I would walk under the canopy of trees and down. Then when I'd get even with the post, I would kind of diagonal off and just kind of slowly let the log or the piece of concrete drop beside the post. And then I would leave. The agent would come an hour later to that post. He would pick up my package and leave a package for me. That way, our packages were on the ground the least amount of time. And it was also a good way for me to know that he'd actually picked the package up. He would leave his package disguised as, one of these milk cartons, or an old oily rag, a nasty, squished up oily rag, or a single glove, sometimes a tin can. And always he'd make it really repulsive so nobody would think it was valuable trash, because people picked trash up in Moscow at the time. In this one instance, I will remember it well, it was mustard plaster. My mother used mustard plaster when she had pneumonia. It was on wax paper, and you'd put it on someone's back, and then you'd put a hot, wet towel, and the heat would go through this mustard onto her back. But Trigon would go to the drugstore in Moscow and get a mustard plaster, a small one, and then he'd wet it, and then he'd drape this stuff over the concealment device. It either looked like baby poo or vomit, and nobody would touch it. I carried a plastic bag with me, though, because it was always kind of nasty. Then, so he would pick up my package, leave his wonderfully disguised package, and then an hour later, I would come back and pick his package up. He would put these miniature cassettes in a prophylactic and tie it up to keep them dry and clean. And that was what he then put inside his concealment device. He also put in there a roll of 35 millimeter film in a black canister, undeveloped. And on this film, he would have taken pictures of a letter that he wrote to us to let us know how he was doing. So in his package, we would get both the little miniature cassettes and this undeveloped 35 millimeter film. We always felt that if someone found this package, they may or may not realize what the cassettes were, but they probably would pull the film out and expose it before any damage would be done. So these notes to us were always very wonderful. We found out all kinds of things about his health. He had health problems. I mean, it was very stressful living this double life without any contact with us. And he told us, different parts of problems with his family or how he was doing, trips he had made. So it was always very informative and always very personal. And really, that was our only personal contact with the agent. We did these exchanges with Trigon, like I said, every other month through 1976. In August of 1976, the same man who made the first pickup, Jack Downing, went into a park, and we actually had a meeting scheduled with Trigon because we wanted him to feel like we were there on his side. The personal touch, the handshake, the embrace, the feeling that we were part of his team. And that turned out very well and very productively. Until the next fall, the next spring, after the winter, we found that there had begun to be some anomalies in his packages. Some of the pictures weren't quite square or maybe were a little out of focus. And we became very concerned that either the stress was getting to him or he had come under suspicion. We had no way of knowing that. We had in one package in April he gave us, there was a little piece of leader in the bottom of that 35 millimeter film canister when we opened it. And we thought maybe somebody had messed with the film. But one thing I learned that day that we developed that film, You know, you can redevelop film, and if you do it properly, you'll never know that it's been developed before. So there were some serious doubts about Trigon's welfare. On June 26, 1977, it was the last scheduled drop to Trigon that we had on the calendar with him, and we were very concerned about him at this point. So I went out with my log in my bag, ready to deliver to him at last, like I had many times before. It was raining that night, and when it's raining in the woods, you can't hear the crunch crunch of leaves as people walk around you. So it was hard to hear whether I was alone in that park. But I went and I put down the package as I always had, and no one was around. So I left the park as it was a real, real storm. When I came back 2 hours later, hoping that Trigon had been there to pick up my package and to leave his package, it was still raining, and as I came into the park, over in that one-way roadway, there was a white van, a small miniature van. The front window of the passenger part of the van was all steamed over, so I thought, well, maybe it's Lover's Lane kind of activities. But I was very uncertain. I walked down into the path, and I decided I'd walk past the pole where I knew his package would be waiting for me. As I came down the hill, I came to a cross path in the path, and a man came right in front of me. He was walking across the path as I was headed down the other path. He had a big military raincoat on. He had a military cap with one of those shower cap things on top, and he had a very large flashlight in his hand. He stopped, I stopped, we both startled. We were so shocked to see anyone in the woods. I continued on the path as he did the other way. I walked quickly down the path and stepped off to the side in case he came back to see whether he could see my profile in the twilight night. But I never saw him again. I waited 20 minutes in the rain, and then I walked across the street and came back the other side of the park to kind of even where I knew where the pole was. And I was looking to see whether anyone else was there. No one was around. And the van was gone. So I thought, well, maybe it was Lover's Lane. I crossed the street hoping there to see his package for me, but of course it was my package that was still there on the ground. So I had to pick it up. I went back home that night feeling very, very concerned for Trigon. I went in the next day to work and told them what had happened, and we were all very concerned. So, like I said, we were out of communication with the agent at that point, but he had this wonderful radio broadcast. He could receive a radio broadcast on shortwave radio. It was a very small portion of the dial. He could dial it to, and he would get this broadcast of numbers out of Germany, and they were spoken in German. And he would write these numbers down, and then he'd take his one-time pad, and he'd get his numbers off of that, decipher the message, and then he would have our message to him. It was an involved, intricate process to do, especially if he'd been nervous or upset. In this message to him, we said, "We were so sorry to meet you that you didn't make us the meeting in Les, but we are willing to meet with you at Setun." This was another of our sites, our caches that we had used before. We said, "If you can, park your car at Parkplatz," which was a parking place in front of his mother's apartment building. And he knew he had to park it within a short period of time. So park your car at Parkplatz on July 14th, which was a Thursday. If you can't park your car there, make a mark at Dieti, which was a child crossing sign in Moscow. He also had a sketch of that. He knew where that was. So make your mark on July 15th, on Friday. So on July 14th, several of us on our way home drove by the site, and his car wasn't there. This was a very bad sign because he really didn't like to make marked signals. The next morning, I drove into work past that sign we called JT, and I didn't have to get very close before I saw it. It was stenciled in red, like, we hope you don't miss this signal. I barely even looked at it as I drove by. I went into the embassy and up to the office and I said, the signal is there, but this is not good. This is not good. It looks like it's stenciled on the sign. We had a brand new chief, a new chief of station, and he said, well, we have to go make this meeting tonight. So I worked my day job all day, and then that night I went up to the station and I picked up the piece of concrete. We went through all the details of where I'd be and what time I would put the package down. I left, I went home, I changed my clothes, I put on the dark slacks, the navy blue sweater, the print blouse, and off I went, as I always did. I drove away from my apartment building. Now, on July 15th in Moscow, it was a beautiful night, and it's still twilight in Moscow because it never really gets dark in Moscow in the summer, so it was really quite daylight as I drove away. As I went down the hill, instead of turning left to go towards the embassy, I turned right because that was a very aggressive move. Where was she going if somebody was following me? But I saw no surveillance. My radio was silent. I drove on. I spent 2.5 hours driving through that city. Actually, what I was doing was looking for surveillance, and I was reminiscing about all my time in Moscow. I had a very bad feeling about that night. I drove, like I said, for 2.5 hours. I parked my car near a metro. I got out of my car, got into the metro, and I drove 2 stops. I changed. I went on to the Ring metro line, and then proceeded to the Lenin Stadium stop, where I got to as a soccer game got out at Lenin Stadium. So the platform was filled with people. So I fought my way towards the escalator where I knew when I'd get up onto the street, I'd know where I was. They'd turned all the escalators to go down. So they were all coming down. I had to turn around and fight my way back to the other side of the platform. I got out onto the street, and it was in a dark park area of Moscow near Lenin Stadium. I walked all around. I'd stop. I'd listen to my radio. I'd look. I was convinced I had no surveillance, so I walked up to the river. As I got to the river, the site was located on top of a railroad bridge in the pedestrian walkway that crossed the river. The bridge was to my left, so I turned away from the bridge. I was a little early. It was 10 minutes to 10. I walked up the river along the Naberezhnaya. If I got up quite a ways, I decided, well, I'd turn around and head back towards the river. As I turned around to come back, I noticed these 3 men across the street from me. And they were walking towards me, but then they turned into the park there, which was Novodevichy Cemetery. That's where Khrushchev is buried, the cosmonauts are buried there, several artists, composers, that kind of thing. It's a very famous cemetery. And of course, it was still twilight out, so it wouldn't be unusual for people to be walking through the cemetery that night. But they had white, bright white shirts on, and I noticed them. I went to the bridge. I walked up the 47 steps to the top of the bridge, and as I got to the top, a train came from behind me with its headlights on, and it shone across the whole span of the bridge, and I could see nobody was out in front of me anywhere along that bridge. So as I got into one of the 4 towers that I had to, there were 2 towers on either side of the bridge, on either side of the track. So I walked into the first tower where the site was located. The package was to be placed in a narrow window on the right. I had done this drop before. Trigon had recovered this package before, so I was confident that he knew where the package would be. I extended my arm full length and left the package there. I walked out into the middle of the bridge, And I stopped and I waited and I listened, and there was no noise in my radio, and I saw nobody around. So I decided I would return back through the tower and down the stairs, which I did. I got about the fourth step from the bottom, and here came those three men in the white shirts across the street walking towards me. They said, the guy in the middle said, "Fan out, don't let her run." They grabbed me like I hadn't been grabbed since I was 4 years old. Well, they grabbed my arms, the guy's standing in front of me, and he's going for my purse. And ladies, what do we do when our purse is attacked? We go like this, right? And what did I do? I drove my arm and his hand into the SR-100 on the side of my bra. Well, therein started the hands into the blouse. They had not a clue what Velcro was. So there was a real struggle to get this undone from the side of my bra, which they did. There's a picture on the back of my book. Actually, it's the picture in the Spy Museum of them with their hands inside my blouse trying to get this thing off. They didn't understand what it was. But within seconds, a van had come from under the railroad bridge. It was like a circus van, and all these people started coming out of the van. And there were men in there. They were all men there. And the one man said, please keep your voice down, because I was saying, you cannot hold me. I'm an American diplomat. You must release me. And I was speaking very loudly. My thought was, if Trigon was in the area, he would leave. He would know that I had been caught. That probably wasn't the case that night, but that was my first instinctual response. So the man told me to keep my voice down. They very quickly reappeared with a piece of concrete. They held it up. There was a guy with a camera, a big camera, a big flash, and it kept going off in my face. And within moments then, they had put me into the van, and off we were taking through Moscow. And I was sure we would end up in Lubyanka prison, which we did. Lubyanka prison, as you recall, was where in the Stalin era, people used to be taken in there, never to be seen again. I had some trepidation. But as we got there to the back of Lubyanka prison, there was a sign on the wall ahead of the KGB. I had no doubt who they were. There was one young policeman. He was the official arresting officer. Everyone else was concerned citizens that just happened to be in the area that night. That's what they would have had me believe. They took me inside the interrogation room, but it was a very large room with a big table in the middle. They had a newspaper in the middle. It was Pravda. That means truth. A piece of Pravda newspaper in the middle of the table. And they put the piece of concrete there and sat me down in the middle. The interrogator was a severe man, clearly a senior KGB officer who was not very happy. But around the edge of the room were young KGB officers who were there, I'm sure, fascinated to see this American spy that had been caught. The interrogator took the package and had his technical person lift the top off, and they started taking things out of the package. This was a bad feeling for me, because all those things we'd packed in there were for Trigon. They were classified. It was the focus of my life in Moscow had been this, and I felt just awful watching them. They took out a roll of film that we also gave back to Trigon with an operational note on it. It was our personal note to him. And the chief interrogator held it up and he started to read it out loud in Russian. It said, "Dear friend, we're so happy to be finally back in contact with you. We have been very concerned about you. In your last package, you asked us about how much money we had held for you in escrow from your earnings for working for us. And that amount is," and that's where the man stopped. Because he knew if he read that huge amount of money, all these people around the room would be headed down to the embassy, take me. He then stopped that, he put that down, and then he began to take the rest of the things out of the rock. And he got to the black pen. He took it out and he laid it over on the corner of the newspaper and he said, "Nobody touch that." And it was at that moment that I realized he thought that was the poison pen, which in fact it wasn't. It was the camera with more cassettes. And that was the aha moment for me when I realized that he probably knew about the poison and that something had happened to Trigon. They called the embassy duty officer who came down to collect me after several hours. They arrested me at 10:30 at night, and at 2 o'clock they told me I could leave. I went back to the embassy, I met with my office and told them what had happened, and the next morning I left Moscow. I was very glad to be leaving. I got back to Washington on Sunday and got to Dulles Airport, where the chief of the group in headquarters, and Jack Downing and his wife, were waiting for me, along with a security officer. So it used to be there was a big black door that swung open when you'd come in international arrivals. So the door swung open and I walked out and we hugged and we were all happy, and there were two other men back quite a ways. And they saw me and they left. And later on, of course, we discovered they were the KGB waiting just to make sure I got home safely, I guess. So that was Sunday. Friday, of course, I'd met the KGB. Monday, I met the director of Central Intelligence, who was Stansfield Turner at the time. He was not a person who really valued our intelligence that we got from Trigon in the same way. He liked satellites and new things like that. But I spoke with him, I told him what had happened, and then Tuesday he took me down to the White House where I met with Jimmy Carter and Zbigniew Brzezinski and told them the story of what had happened. Zbigniew Brzezinski said, "I greatly admire what you did in Moscow." When Jimmy Carter asked me if I would be returning to Moscow, I told him no, I didn't think I'd ever go back to Moscow. Zbigniew Brzezinski knew the value of Trigon's intelligence. Both he and Kissinger had been the national security chiefs, and they knew the value of this type of information. What Trigon gave them was a picture of the world they could get from no single source. He was looking at the whole world through the Soviet ambassador's eyes. And you can only imagine how valuable that was for these men to go and sit down with Anatoly Dobrynin in Washington, D.C. and have these discussions about SALT and START treaties and all things like that, and how valuable it was to have the Soviets' position beforehand. So I was declared persona non grata from the Soviet Union, and I will never return there. Persona non grata means you are a diplomat and we don't ever want to see you here. We don't acknowledge you anymore. So I went back to work in CIA headquarters, and a year later, June of 1978, I was called in my office and told that it was out, that Reuters had the story about my arrest. You see, at the time we had these rules. It was wonderful. There are no rules anymore, but at the time we had rules with the Soviet Union, as well as Eastern European countries. If the FBI would arrest one of theirs, the FBI wouldn't publicize it. So if the KGB arrested one of ours, they wouldn't publicize it. Well, the FBI decided they'd change the rules, and they publicized the arrest of three Soviets on the New Jersey Turnpike in late May of 1978. They were meeting with an American U.S. Navy officer who was a double agent, who was pretending to work for the Soviets, but in fact was an FBI agent. The FBI decided they'd publicize that, so that was why the Reuters had the story. The Soviets had decided to publicize my arrest. So I went home to my townhouse in Falls Church, Virginia. I got inside the house and the phone rang. So I picked up the phone and it man said, "Hi, this is Jim Blow. I'm with Newsweek. Is this Martha Peterson?" And I said, "No," and I hung up. I figured, well, that was simple. It got a little more difficult than that. Then I went and watched all three. Remember when we only had three news services, ABC, NBC, and CBS, right? And even Walter Cronkite said, and in Moscow today, the Soviet Union announced the arrest of Martha Peterson. And I'm looking at Walter, and I'm looking at my picture on TV thinking, how can this be? I'm a covert CIA officer. So I went on and had a wonderful new career after that. I didn't quit working. I still was a covert officer. And people say, well, how could you be undercover? It was in the newspaper. Your face was all over. The dentist now knows who you are. And I said, you know what? In Washington, you just say, Soviet propaganda. Don't know what they're talking about. You know, the newspapers never have it right. And, you know, in Washington, it kind of, it's okay, people just go along with it. Either they realized what had happened and was true, or they really did believe that it was just Soviet propaganda. So in 1980, the Soviet chief of the KGB, Andropov, gave to a Soviet spy novelist, Yuri Semyonov, the file on Trigon, and he wrote a fictionalized book about Trigon. It's called TASS's Authorized to Announce. And it got, you know, very good reviews in Moscow. And it followed very loosely the Trigon story. In 1980, if you recall, the U.S. boycotted the Olympics in Moscow. You remember why? It's the invasion of Afghanistan. Then in 1984, the Soviets decided that they would boycott the Los Angeles Olympics because tit for tat. Well, in 1984, then the Soviets had a whole lot of TV space that wasn't going to be taken up with their Soviet, you know, heroes winning gold medals. So they decided to serialize the book TASS is Authorized to Announce. So every night, people would race home in Moscow to watch this on TV. And you know, it was the greatest thing, and compared to our series called Dallas. So the Soviets would run home to watch this show. Well, the last episode of TASS is Authorized to Announce, here comes a CIA officer walking up to a bridge, right?
Oh, God.
And it's a man. So let me tell you what happened to Trigon. Trigon had been a faithful agent. He had never turned coat. But CIA had hired a translator called Carl Kocher. And he translated the teletaps from the Soviet embassy in Bogota. And from that, Carl Kocher figured out who this CIA, who this agent was that CIA probably was interested in. Carl Kocher was a Czech citizen who'd come to the US. He and his wife had were participants in these sex clubs. It was a very strange thing that CIA actually picked him up, but he spoke so many languages, and he was, of course, a contractor for CIA. The Czech Intel Service knew about Carl Kocher. He had volunteered to them, and they told the Soviets about Carl Kocher. And Kocher then said, you know, I think it's one of these four people in the embassy in Bogota. And that's how Trigon was uncovered. The Soviets arrested him in his apartment as he was taking out a small canister that had his communications plan in it. When asked, you know, what he was doing, he said, I will give you a full and complete account of what I did for the Americans. He said, if you give me a pad of paper and my pen, I will write a full confession. He took the pen and he bit down and expired right before their eyes. So that's why this man that was interrogating me was so angry. They really got they had no idea of the damage Trigon had done. And that is why, to me, Trigon is an amazing hero of our world. So this story that I have told you is in my book. It's also on the military channel. For those who watch military channel, it's called Shadow Ops. And the piece that's my story is called Codename Trigon. So if you're interested in more information about that. My story was read and approved 4 times by CIA. I felt like I wanted to be fully compliant with their rules. They were very pleased that I did write this story. It was a way to get maybe a better story out than other stories you hear about CIA. So that is my story, and I'll be glad to take any questions, and I have books for sale tonight. So. I knew Rick Ames. Rick and I studied Russian before I went to Moscow, and I consider him to be one of the most despicable human beings. After I said that in one talk, someone said, but he was a spy just like Trigon. He was just spying for the wrong side. That's it. He forgot who he was working for, I think. He sits in a prison in Pennsylvania. He's free only 1 hour a day. And I only wish you couldn't read books. That would be the fitting thing. Yes?
At what point did your parents find out what you did? And what was their reaction?
Linda has known me since I was 2 or 3 years old,
so
forever.
Well.
Yes. My parents knew when I went to Moscow that I worked for CIA, but they had no idea what I was doing. I never explained that to them. So when I was arrested, I came home and I sat down and kind of gave them a bare bones of what I had been doing, but it was so shocking to them. This story I've told you tonight, I find strange that I'm actually telling it out loud. And I think I felt the same way. And my parents were very supportive. The one reporter from the grocery store newspaper, The Star, actually found them, and my mother invited him in. You know, come in for coffee. And she sat down and chatted about what a wonderful daughter Martha was, but of course gave them no information. Yeah, it was quite a shock.